This is another Debate Talk For You Radio public announcement. The views and opinions expressed by individuals on this platform, the callers, plus invited guests, are their own. The information you hear does not reflect the overall views of all parties associated with this brand. We encourage everyone to research all things heard live or via archive for edification purposes. Discretion is advised.
That dial. You're now listening to Debate Talk For You Radio.
Today's show is entitled Letter of the Law versus Spirit of the Law Part 2. Once again, today's show is entitled Letter of the Law versus Spirit of the Law Part 2. Part 1, we had Brother Josh and Brito here having a dialogue about this topic. And for part two, we're going to have Brandon Blue and Brito back. Well, Brandon Blue has been here for a while, but he's going to be back. And Brito's going to be here as well. I believe this is him right now. We need to see. 773, you're live. Who am I speaking to? Yeah, 773. Hold on. All right, we're on the air. We got you. What's going on, Brito? How you feeling?
What's up, Sal? Peace. Peace. Hope everything good with you.
Yeah, everything copacetic, man. Everything copacetic, man. As my father would say all the time, copacetic. Yeah. What's going
that's
on,
New
man?
York
is Brandon Blue? Yeah. Is Brandon Blue joining you, or he's going to call in?
I think he's going to call in. I talked to him earlier, so he probably called in. He said he's going to call in early, but you may see his number pop up on there, and I can probably see what his area code is, but he can join in whenever you get a chance to call in.
All right, so Brandon Blue, if you out there, you got to press number one, brother. You got to press number one, and we'll bring you in a conversation. We have a lot of people on the phone line, so I'm going to try to search for your number. But if anything is press number one,
I'll look up his the three digits real quick, and then I can tell you what it is so you'll know what to look for.
Yeah. All right, send that to me. Yeah, but I was explaining to the audience that part one went down with you and Brother Josh, you know, and so we're doing a part two right here on the Debate Talk For You Radio. So pen and pads ready, take down some notes. And I just want to let the family know that those people out there that actually donated to keep the Summer Special on, I really, really appreciate the family out there that's, you know, been sending $5, you know, $2, $3, $4, or, you know, anything you can send to keep this show going for the Summer Special. Everybody knows that for the past few months, I had some medical issues. I had a surgery done. So, of course, when it comes to the medical aspect, you know, I have to pay the medical bills. So any little help that you guys have done, and I appreciate you guys. And that's why the Summer Special is going down live right now, because of the family that donated. So we appreciate you guys out there that tuned into the program and keep supporting it, you know. So we appreciate you. But let's check in with Brito. Yeah, man, I don't see Brandon Blue pressing number one. You want to start this thing, and then I'll try to bring him in?
Yeah, I'm good. Yeah, we're good.
All right, so, yeah, let's get it started, man. And Brandon Blue, if you're out there, press number one. I'll bring you in, brother. All right, good.
All right, cool. Basically, I wanted to do this part two. I would have liked if Josh would have been able to get on here as well, but I don't think he was able to get on here. So there were so many things in that dialogue and that conversation that me and the brother had that I wasn't really able to bring out as far as, you know, the spirit of the letter and the letter of the law and the spirit of the law. Right now is a high time. A lot of people are attacking the Bible, man. Like I see it, you know, all throughout the YouTube world and things of that nature. And what I'm noticing and the reason why a lot of people, from my perspective and my opinion, is attacking the Bible, it's because we have the wrong people breaking down the meanings and the esoterics and the symbols of the Bible. And a lot of people are now, especially in this age, are able to go outside of the text, and they are beginning to see that those who take the Bible literal really don't understand it or know what they are, know what they're talking about when it comes to the Bible. Me personally, I stepped away for a while to find the true meaning of what the Bible really is, and really what the Bible, the understanding of the Bible, you know, because I was brought up in the whole Israelite movement, and I had a lot of doctrines, and I kept a lot of doctrines and things of that nature. And what we did was argue, debate, fight, all the things that really Christ in the Bible taught against, you know what I mean? That we are supposed to love each other and show love and peace and, you know, the fruits of the Spirit, which I'm going to go through some of those verses. I just want to just do this opening statement. In that paradigm, we come out of Christianity. And what it is that we come out of Christianity and we feel like, oh, man, Christianity keeping us lawless. We don't have no laws in Christianity. And the funny thing about it is Christianity does teach laws. Like, they do tell you you shouldn't kill, you shouldn't steal, all the things of the letter. And then when you become a Hebrew, it's the same thing. You know, the only thing that's pretty much added to the Hebrew Israelite paradigm is the dietary law, maybe feast days, because some brothers keep feast days, some brothers don't. And then the Sabbath day, you know, that's the only thing that's added. On my journey, I realized that none of that led to life, as the Bible talks about, that many are called, few are chosen. So what I want to do is I want to open this up. I'm going to the Bible, but what I want to do first, I want to open this up in the Essenes Gospel of Peace. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to go in the Bible and begin to break down the way to life, because sin and the law, when we think about the law, you know, it says that sin is the transgression of the law. So what we have to establish is, what is the law? Is the law a symbol? What is the law a symbol of? And I want to touch on some of those things today. And we're going to start here. And this is the Essenes Gospel of Peace. Anybody can type this into Google and pull up the book. It's online. It's, you don't have to pay for it or none of that. Okay, so it says here, and Jesus himself sat down in their midst and said, I tell you truly, none can be happy except he do the law. And others answered, we all do the laws of Moses, our lawgiver, even as they are written in the Holy Scriptures. Now, this is what I hear today, you know, and this used to be me. I used to be like, man, I'm keeping the law. You know, when I was on the line, I had a brother call in and ask a question about, do you keep kosher? Do you do this and do you do that? You know what I mean? So he felt as if he was keeping the law, right? Because this is what Moses, this is the lawgiver. Okay, so look at what Jesus said. And Jesus answered, seek not the law in your scriptures, for the law is life. Now, this is what I'm saying. I'm telling you that this law is life. Whereas the scriptures is dead. I tell you truly, Moses received not his laws from God in writing, but through the living word. Okay, so the Bible tells us that Christ is the living word. The Bible tells us in the book of Revelation, I'm not sure exactly where the verse is, but it says, and his name is the word of God. And that is that Christ, and that's that Christ that's within you. Okay, so it says, but through the living word.
I hate to interrupt, but Brandon Lewis here.
So it says, but through the living word. The law is the living word of the living God. So it says the law is the living word. Okay, so again, the Bible, and I'm going to go through some verses that shows this, that Christ is synopsis or is a symbol for the law. So it says the law is the living word of the living God, to living prophets, for living men, and everything that is life is the law written. So everything that we can see, that you can look outside and you can see the law is written, okay? You can find it in the grass, in the tree, in the river, in the mountain, in the birds of heaven, in the fishes of the sea, but seek it chiefly in yourself, okay? So we have here Jesus telling us to seek the law in ourselves. Okay, so this is what Jesus was teaching. For I tell you truly, all living things are nearer to God than the scripture which is without life. And when I first read this, I'm like, man, this is crazy, because how is this saying that the scriptures don't have life? But then when I step back, I start to realize it really don't have life, because those who take the book literal and those who take the law literal, they are not in life. They dwell in darkness. They dwell in death. And I'm going to show you how and break it down and how the Bible concludes this, because sin is attached to death. The law is attached to death. Okay? So it says, God so made life and all living things that they might by the everlasting word teach the laws of the true God to men. So we can see through the creation the laws of God. This is how He teaches us through the creation. God wrote not the laws in the pages of books, but in your heart and in your spirit. They are in your breath, your blood, your bones, and your flesh, your bowels, your eyes, your ears, and in every little part of your body. They are present in the air, in the water, in the earth, in the plants, in the sunbeams, in the depths, and the heights. They all speak to you that you may understand the language or the tongue and the will of the living God. But you shut your eyes that you may not see, and you shut your ears that you may not hear. Why do we do that? You know, because we have been taught this since a child. Our parents has been taught this since a child. Religion has separated us from the Creator. Religion has took us away from the very God that's within us and has taught us to look at everything outside of ourselves and not understand that we are the creation, that we are a part of the Creator, that we are the Creator in a sense. Okay? It says, I tell you truly that the Scripture is the work of man, but life and all its hosts are the work of our God. Wherefore do you not listen to the words of God which are written in his works? And wherefore do you study the dead scriptures which are the works of the hands of men? Now, and I'm going to read a little bit more of this, I'm going to the Bible. So now, when you think about, when it talks about the works of the hands of men, how many different denominations of churches and sects that we have out here that takes the Bible literal and they try to validate, oh, this happened here, or this prophecy got to take place, or wait, this prophecy was fulfilled. You have people that are full preterists that teach the Bible is fully fulfilled. Then you have futurists that tells you that the Bible isn't fulfilled and things ought to be fulfilled, right? So they have a division or a dividing point in what they understand the text to say, but the Bible clearly points you to yourself. It points you to the Christ that's within you. You understand what I'm saying? So this is why they walk in darkness. This is why they walk in death. This is why they follow the works of the hands of men. When you look at people break down this, they go into what? History books. Let me show you what these men wrote down, what these men saying. That's the works of men. That's not the works of God. That's a tradition that was passed on and a belief that was passed on. But God that's been within you or this law that's been within you, it's already in you. You just have to find it. Okay, this Christ has to resurrect in you. So let me finish. I tell you truly, God and his laws are not in that which you do. They are not in gluttony. Oh, hold on. I skipped something. Okay, here we go. How may we? Okay, so this is a good question. How may we read the laws of God elsewhere than in the scriptures? That's a good question. Where are they written? Even though he just told them where it was written, and he said it was written in the stars, and the grass and things of that nature. They didn't even get that. And this is what happened today when people who talk of the spirit, the carnal mind just don't understand it. So then they begin to ask the question again, right? Then they say, read them to us from there where you see them, for we know nothing else but the scriptures which we have inherited from our forefathers. Tell us the laws of which you speak, that hearing them we may be healed and justified. Jesus said, you do not understand the words of life because you are in death. So when we speak of life and when we speak of this spirit, when we speak of life, many people don't understand this. This is why the Bible says my sheep will hear my voice. You know what I mean? So we speak of life. We're trying to free you from darkness. We're trying to, you know, as the Bible says, Christ raised him from the dead. We're trying to raise you from the dead. We're trying to give you life, which is already within you. But because of the tradition and the religion that separated you from that, you can't see that, okay? So it says, he says, darkness darkened your eyes and your ears are stopped with deafness. For I tell you, it profits you not at all that you pore over dead scriptures if by your deeds you deny him who has given you the scriptures. Now, who has given them the scriptures? This is talking about Christ, okay? This is talking about the Christ that's within you, okay? So now let's go into the Bible now. I'm done with that. I don't know, Blue, are you on here?
Yeah, I'm here. You can hear me?
Okay, yeah, I just wanted to, if you want to ask something, you're free to ask something. If not, I'm going to just roll.
Yeah, I'm just sitting back and listening.
Okay. Okay, so now what we're going to do is I'm going to go into the Bible now, and we're going to back that up, what I just read, with the Bible, because I know a lot of people, you know, may say, oh, he's reading the Essenes Gospel, that's not the Bible. And, you know, some people may say that's a false book, and that's fine because I'm not talking about the book, but the message that's in that book, you know, I don't worship that book, okay? But the message, it coincides with the spirit, okay? So what we're going to do is we're going to go to Matthew. I'm going to go to Matthew chapter 7, and I'm going to read verse 12 through 14. I'm trying to use this Bible hood. I'm kind of new to this, so bear with me. I might have to use my phone. Okay, so here we go. Matthew chapter 7. Hold on. Matthew 7, verse 12. Okay, here we go. All right, so this says, let me get there. All right, this is KJV. Therefore, all things whatsoever you do that men should do to you, do ye even so to them. For this is the law and the prophets. So we see here, do unto others as you do unto yourself, which ultimately means love your brother as you love yourself. Okay, let's look at verse 13. Enter ye in at the straight gate, for wide is the gate and broad is the way that leadeth to destruction, and many there be which go in therein. So many go into them. Many don't open this straight gate, many don't enter into the straight gate, which we're going to explain. The straight gate is talking about the kingdom of God. Okay, let's go to verse 14. Okay, verse 14 says, let me get there. All right, get there real quick. Now I kind of understand why people hire readers. All right, because straight is the gate and narrow is the way which leadeth unto life, and few be there that find it. So we see here that straight is the gate, and there was the way which leadeth to what? Life. And what did I just read about life? That the spirit is life. So it'd be few that'll be that finest. So when you look at the religions, the Christians, the Muslims or whatever, these are big religions, and they don't lead you to life because they separate you from the Christ that's within you. So we have to understand, it says it'd be few that find it. So when those that find it, you're not gonna understand them, because as Jesus stated, your eyes are closed and your ears are closed. So, of course, those that find it, you're not going to understand them, because they speak in spirit. They speak in that spiritual language. Okay? So let's look at Matthew chapter 16. I'm going to go to Matthew chapter 16, and I'm going to just read one verse, verse 19. Okay? And verse 19 says, let me put this on King James Version. So I don't keep getting all these different versions popping up when I scroll. All right, here we go. And verse 19 says, and I will give unto thee, which he was talking to Peter, which Peter means the rock, okay? And I will give unto thee the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatsoever thou shalt bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatsoever thou shalt loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. So we see here that we have keys to the kingdom of heaven, right? What is that talking about? What is the keys to the kingdom of heaven? This is what everybody's searching for. This is what religion teaches you, that you're going to go to heaven or that you're going to get into the kingdom of God. But we see here that there's already a key to get to this kingdom, right? So let's find out what that's talking about. Let's go to Luke chapter 11, and I'm going to read verse 52. Okay? As soon as I get there, anytime. Okay, here we go. Luke 11, 52. It says, woe unto you lawyers, for you have taken away the key of knowledge. You enter not in yourselves, and them that were entering in you hinder. So these lawyers are the literalists, or the laws, the ones who teach the law of the flesh, the letter of the law. These are the lawyers, for they've taken away the key of knowledge. They have taken those who are seeking for the Christ within them, those who are seeking for the kingdom. These lawyers, these people who are telling you about, oh, you got to keep this Torah or you got to keep this law, the law of the flesh, these are the ones who have taken away this key of knowledge, because you're trying to enter in. That's what the kingdom is. Let's find out what the kingdom is. Let's go into the kingdom. Let's see what these lawyers is trying to prevent you from getting to. We're going to go to Luke 17, and we're going to read verse 21. Okay? Neither shall they say, lo here, or lo there, for behold, the kingdom of God is within you. Okay, so this is what Jesus is talking about entering into the key. the keys to the kingdom. The key is the entering in, those entering in. The kingdom of God is within you. This is spirit, okay? This kingdom is a spiritual kingdom. It's one that's within you. But watch this, though. Watch this. Let's look at something else real quick. So this kingdom is within you. The key of knowledge is to those who enter in. The key was given to Peter, well, the keys which is given to the rock, which we are, which is Christ. And this is how we go into ourselves, which we go into ourselves through meditation and things of that nature, as I stated in the first conversation that we had. Okay? So let's look at Psalms. I'm going to read Psalms 48. And then I'm going to go to verse, I'm going to read Psalm 48, and I'm going to go to verse 9. 1 second. Psalms 48. Okay. It says, "We have thought of thy loving kindness, O God, in the midst of thy temple." Okay, so in the midst of thy temple. I like this other version. I want to read this other version. I like the way it kind of reads. This is the New International Version, I believe. It says, "Within your temple, O God, we meditate on your unfailing love." So what is this talking about? Many people who study the scriptures understand that we are the temple of God, you know, and to meditate is to go within thyself. Again, to touch this kingdom that is within you. So even in the book of Psalms, we see that within your temple, which is within thy body, because, and let me read that, matter of fact. Let me go to that and read that. Okay. 1 Corinthians chapter 3 and then verse 16. Okay. It says, "Don't you know that you yourselves are God's temple and that God's spirit dwells in your midst?" So we see here that the God's spirit dwells within us or in our midst. The kingdom of God is within us. So here's a symbol. God and the kingdom are a symbol now, because we can see that the kingdom is within us, and we can also see that God's spirit is within us, right? So let's look at something else. Now, the writers of the Old Testament, they used a lot of symbols, and the temple was one of the symbols that they used, okay? So we can look at either this will be a contradiction, or we can understand that the New Testament reveals the symbols that's written in the Old Testament, right? So we know in the Old Testament that we have a physical or literal temple in a sense, and God dwells in that physical and literal temple, right? We just found out in the New Testament that the body is the temple and that the Spirit of God dwells in that temple. So we get revelation of what was written in the Old text, and we get revelation in the New text that it was referring to our body, right? So let's look at Acts 17 and verse 24. It says, "The God who made the world and everything in it, it is the Lord of heaven and earth and does not live in temples built by human hands." Okay, I didn't go back to the KJV, but it's the same thing. So God doesn't dwell in temples made with hands. But in the Old Testament, we could kind of see that, you know, they were building temples in the temple when God was to dwell in that temple. So now we see that the temple is a symbol for the body. You understand what I'm saying? So this is one of the things that I want people who are Bible believers and Bible students to understand, that the Bible is a mystery. And it's our job to look at this book as a mystery, not as a historical book or things of that nature. And you can do whatever you want. I'm not telling you what to do. But this is the reason why people are attacking the Bible today, because those who just read it and take it literal, they have no answers for none of this. They can't show the people that the name Peter means rock or stone, and that the rock that followed them was Christ. You understand what I'm saying? They're not showing the people the mysteries of the Bible to keep them looking within themselves. They're just pointing on the outward man or the outward things, which is dealing with the law and not the spirit. Okay? So let's look at something else. I want to look at Proverbs. I hope I ain't going too fast, because I know I'll be in it. Hold on. I want to look at Proverbs chapter 6, and we're going to look at verse 23. Let me get back to the KJV too. don't want nobody saying nothing.
Well, just to let you know, we got some social media questions and comments whenever you're ready for them.
Okay. I'm going to read a few more, then I'll take them. I'll get them so I can keep going. Okay, so Proverbs chapter 6 and verse 23. It says, "For the commandment is a lamp, and the law is light, and reproof of instructions are the way of life." Right? So we see here that the commandment is a lamp, and the law is light. That's a symbol. Okay? The law is a symbol for light. Let's look at what light is. I mean, the Bible pretty much, it says the same thing, but just in different, it just used different words. It just says it in different ways. Okay, so this is 1 John chapter 1 and verse 5. It says, "This then is the message which we have heard of him and declared unto you, that God is light, and in him is no darkness at all." So we see here that God is light. But we read in Proverbs, it said that the law is light. So now we have God, the law being a symbol of God. So this law is not something outside of you. This law is something that's within you. But because we've been taught to look outside of ourselves again, this is why we follow things outward and we follow the traditions of men and not the spirit that dwells within man. Okay, let's look at, I don't know what I wrote down here. All right, you can, if you want to, You can ask the question. Let me see.
All right. So let's go to the questions on social media. Remember, you guys can call in. The number is 319-527-6239. Let me check the chat room. Okay, no action there. Let me read some of these comments. Well, questions. One question is the Bible a great reference book to break down the metaphysical mentality?
Ask it one more time. Is the Bible a workman's book?
Yeah, let me read it to you again. Is the Bible a great reference book
reference
to break down the metaphysical mentality?
I say yes. It's a good book for that. Yeah, that's the purpose of the book in a sense.
Another one. Can you describe to the audience what exactly is the Christ in you? When you say that, are you let me read it again. Can you describe to the audience what exactly is the Christ in you? When you say that, are you referring to a characteristic in a person or an actual supreme being in all of us?
That's a good question. The Bible says that Christ, outside of the Bible, it says that Christ is the wisdom and power of God. So that is the Christ is a part of God, the same way that we see in the story that Jesus was the flesh and then the Christ was within the body. So I would say that would be, I wouldn't say a supreme being, but I would say energy in a sense. I would say it would be the consciousness or the energy of God. Not necessarily like
Blue,
a supreme being.
Yeah, I was going to ask Brandon Blue if he wanted to bring his perspective on it. Yeah, Brandon.
Oh, okay. On that question. I believe the Christ in you, Christ is just the anointing of God, which is basically God within you. Like when you read anywhere in the Bible, it'll say God dwells in you, the Holy Spirit dwells in you, and Christ dwells in you. So these are just three names for the same presence as dwelling within you. And I would say, you know, it is the presence of God. You could read this throughout the book.
Same person asks, is there a supreme dark side in you?
A supreme dark side? Well, I didn't say it was a supreme being, so a supreme dark side. I mean, man has knowledge of both good and evil in a sense. I was going to go into that a little bit, into the Garden of Eden, which I'm going to touch on that a little bit, but before I go into that, I'll just say that we have knowledge of both good and evil, but good and evil is a balance. So man looks at good and evil as a duality, whereas the spirit looks at good and evil as a polarity, as a balance. And I'm gonna go into that a little bit. So So to answer this question, it's not a supreme darkness or whatever, man. I don't know if you want to touch on that, Blue.
I would say no. There's no supreme darkness in a man, but when a man comes to that Christ within him, all is light. I'll say that.
Exactly.
All right, I'll let you know when any more stuff pop up that's interesting on social media. Again, guys, you can call in, y'all, 319-527-6239, press number 1, and we can hear from you. Good, though.
Okay. So, now, that just led me somewhere, so I was gonna go somewhere else, but that question is going to lead me to looking at this, the word sin in the Garden of Eden. I want to kind of touch on that a little bit. So, I'll go there now since that question got brought up. Breaking the parable down. So what I want to look at is that, you know, everybody, I don't have to really too much go too far into the, you know, the whole text of the story and things of that nature. But what I want to do is I want to read, and I'm going to take it real slow because when I'm breaking this stuff down, I can't be fast on this. So I want people to understand. So we see here that we know that God formed man of the dust of the ground is what it says. It says, but there were, and he breathed in his nostrils, verse 7, it says, and the Lord God formed man out of dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life. So we're dealing with life here. And man became a living soul. So at this particular moment, from what I see and understanding, because I look at this as a parable, that man at this particular time was given that life that I read about in the Gospel of Peace, that he had this spirit, he had this law that was already within him. There was no law outside of him. In this particular story, okay? So then we know God planted a garden eastward and he put the man there and things of that nature. So I'm not, and then we know about the trees of good and evil and the tree of life. But what I want to focus on is he told them, let me get to that point. Verse 15. It says, and the Lord God took the man and put him into the garden of Eden to dress it and to keep it. And the Lord commanded the man. So here we go. We have a law right here. So before man, when he created man, man was already given this inward law. Okay. Then when we get down here, we get in the outward law. Because now it says, and the Lord God commanded the man, saying, of every tree of the garden thou may freely eat, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil thou shalt not eat of it, for in the day that thou eatest thereof thou shalt surely die. Now, this is where the law of sin and death actually begins, because when this commandment gets broken, there's now death put in front of Adam or in front of man, okay? So before that, man had law already. Law existed in creation. The creator didn't create or, you know, the things of that nature in this story without things having order. Everything was being put in order. If you take the creation story literal, you can see that. And God saw and it was good, and God saw and it was good, and God saw it was good. So when he created man, what he saw was good. There was nothing bad about what was done. The thing that happens here is now this outward law begins. So what I like to say is it's just like with anything else. If somebody tells you you can do something or you can't do something, your mind begins to have a thought now. You have a thought process or a desire, in a sense, to do against that law. Okay, so this is what the letter of the law and the spirit of the law is basically dealing with, because now, I don't want to go too fast, so let me slow down. Okay, so we see here that we see death being put on the table in a sense, and we see a commandment. Okay, so then we know the story. I don't have to, you know, basically break down the whole story. We know that Adam and Eve or whatever transgressed that outward law, the law of the flesh. And then they begin, and then they got kicked out of the garden, and then they died. So now this is where you get the law of sin and death, the sacrifices, all that begin here. Before you even read anything about Moses, the Israelites, any of that, this is the beginning of the law of sin and death. Okay? So I want to look at something else. Let's look at the story of Cain and Abel. Okay? So we know that God, in that story, he cursed the ground. Okay? So the ground was cursed at this particular time, the same way that you see in the story of the Israelites. They had blessings and they had curses. You know what I mean? all the way down, you see blessings and curses. So when we deal with Cain and Abel, let's look at this. It says, and Adam knew Eve, his wife, and she conceived and bare Cain and said, I have gotten a man from the Lord. So now Cain is a man, and which we know they're all men, but in a sense, it's an emphasis on that. And she again bare his brother Abel, and Abel was a keeper of the sheep. Okay, so now right here we have left to right. We have flesh to spirit in a sense. Okay, but Cain was a tiller of the ground. Now we already know that the ground was cursed. So Abel he's the right side. He's the spirit, as Christ said, the goats and the sheep or whatever. So Abel is a representation of the spirit, right? And Cain is a representation of the flesh. These are things that's in man. These are Cain and Abel is a part of you. This Cain and this Abel, you have the spirit that's within you, and you have the flesh. This is why Paul wrote, and Paul breaks it down, that the flesh war with the spirit and the spirit with the flesh. This is what this story is breaking down. Again, this is a symbol, okay? And it says, and Abel, he also brought of the firstlings of his flock. Okay, I skipped. And in the process of time, it came to pass that Cain brought of the fruit of the ground an offering unto the Lord. And Abel, he also brought of the firstlings of his flocks and of the fat thereof. And the Lord had respect unto Abel and to his offering, but unto Cain and to his offering, he had not respect. All right? So, I mean, the way I view this is that this ground was cursed, and he's bringing the Lord a cursed offering, which is the flesh. Okay? At this particular moment, the flesh was not accepted. Okay? He says, and Cain was very wroth, and his countenance fell. So Cain was angry. Why? Because he's out there working in this cursed ground, and God won't even accept his offering. Like, wait, this is what the flesh is. This is how the flesh fights out against the spirit. Okay? And the Lord said unto Cain, why are you angry, and why is your face fallen? If you do well, shall thou not be accepted? And if thou dost not well, sin lieth at the door, and unto thee shall be his desire, talking about sin, and thou shalt rule over him. Okay, so this is dealing with sin not being accepted and the flesh, right? So he says, if you don't do well, sin lieth at your door. We know what sin is attached to, right? Sin is attached to death. So what did the flesh try? What does the flesh do to the spirit? And Cain talked with Abel, his brother, and it came to pass when they were in the field that Cain rose up against Abel, his brother, and killed him. That's what the flesh want to do to the spirit. That's what goes on right now. This is why Paul said, do I become your enemy because I tell you the truth? Because I'm telling you that this Bible is not a history book. Because I tell you that this Bible is a book that has deeper meaning. Because I tell you that it has deeper meanings, and it's not something that we should take literal. What does they want to do? They want to kill me. Why? Because when you understand the spirit, it takes away from the flesh. Everybody that's in the flesh has these religious camps, these churches. They're getting money. You know, they don't want you to know that God is within you, because when you find out that God is within you, what you need them for? As the Bible says, the anointing shall teach you all things and lead you into all things. Why I gotta go to his church for and listen to him put a Bible lesson together? Why do I gotta go to church listen to a preacher tell me what God got to say? This is Cain. The religion is a representation of Cain. And those who are in the spirit, if they want to kill you. This is what they want to do to you, because you're going to take away from their pocketbook. You're going to take away from their congregation and from them teaching. They don't want you to know this. Okay? So this is what I come to point out. And even if you disagree with the way that I break this down, the spirit can give you an even better breakdown for you. When you look at Cain and Abel as flesh and spirit. And when you look at Cain and Abel as being a part of you with your mind that battles within yourself. Okay? So, and like I say, Paul actually broke this down pretty good. Okay, so I wanted to point that out in that story just to show you that it's a symbol. Now let me go back to, this is one of the chapters that I wanted to really get into and I couldn't because I'm not going to point no fingers, but okay, so I want to look at this real quick, and I'm going to take this one slow also. Okay, this is 2 Corinthians chapter 3, Okay, so do we begin again to commend ourselves, or need we, as some other epistles of commendation to you, or letters of commendation from you? You are our epistles written in our hearts, known and read of all men. See, this is dealing with the Spirit again. For as much you are manifestly declared to be the epistles of Christ, ministered by us, written not with ink, but with the Spirit of the living God, not in tables of stones, but in fleshly tables of the heart. So what I was trying to get, when we were talking about this on part one, what I was trying to get out was that, you know, we went back and we read Moses, the part of Moses, and things of that nature, about how his face shone and things of that nature. I wasn't able to get into this breakdown. So it's telling us here that Christ is ministered by us, written not with ink, but with the Spirit of the living God. Okay, so the Spirit of the living God is what's within all men. Okay, so when we minister Christ, or when we talk about Christ, this is just not in the Bible. This is just not in a book. This is in your walk. This is the fruits of the Spirit. This is who you are. You don't have to just go in the Bible to break down Christ and say, you know, this Christ within me, I got to go break this Bible down and show people that Christ within me. No. And this is not to take away from the Bible, because, again, I'm a firm believer that the Bible is divinely inspired, and that it has great wisdom in it, and that it has great, like, you know, I believe in that. You know what I mean? But it's not all be all. Like, if I go in the book of Essenes, Gospel of Peace, and read something there, or if I meditate within myself and the Creator speaks to me or whatever, you know what I mean? Or I get a feeling or a vibe or whatever, and the Creator is directing me. It doesn't have to just be in the Bible, because we are living in the moment now. Life isn't this. Wasn't no computers back when they were writing these Bibles. Wasn't no cars and airplanes and things of that nature. Wasn't none of that. So that's all a part of Christ. How Christ lead and guide you in the direction. If you don't understand that, it's just not in the Bible. That's what this is. That's basically what this is saying. Okay. And it says, and such trust have we through Christ to Godward, meaning to become sons of God, from Christ to sons of God. Not that we are sufficient of ourselves to think anything as of ourselves, but our sufficiency is of God. So we don't boast and talk about what we do. I don't talk and say, I keep this law, you keep this law. You eat kosher, I don't eat kosher. I'm a vegan. Are you a vegan? Oh, no, you shouldn't be. No, we don't do none of that. We don't boast in ourselves. We don't have to do that. There's no point in that. Everything we speak is of Christ, is of God. We say, we give God all the glory. God leads us. God guides our footsteps. God guides my footsteps. Not me. I don't do things on my own. It's the Christ within me that's able to do that. And Paul again breaks that down. And even Jesus breaks that down when he say, I and God is one, and I don't do things, not me, but the Father who in heaven. So even Jesus was led by the Spirit. Okay? So it says, who also have made us able ministers of the New Testament, not of the letter, but of the Spirit. For the letter kills, but the Spirit gives life. Okay, so we see here that the letter, and from my understanding, the letter deals with the literal interpretation of the Bible. Okay, and the Spirit gives life. The Spirit deals with the esoteric, the pointing of the self, the pointing to self-realization, the Christ that's within you. That's what gives life. Okay, but if, and I'm gonna skip down because I could keep going, but we kind of touched on some of this. But it was something that we missed, and I wanted to break down. Okay, so verse 13 says, and not as Moses, which put a veil over his face, that the children of Israel could not steadfastly look to the end of that which is abolished, but their minds were blinded. Okay, for until this day remaineth the same veil untaken away in the reading of the Old Testament, which veil is done away in Christ. So that's what I wanted to touch on. So we know what a veil is. A veil is a blinder, being in darkness, not having eyes to see. It says their mind were blinded. Okay, so the mind is blinded. When I just went into the Old Testament and just looked at, for example, the Cain and Abel story, that veil is done away in Christ. So now I can look at that Cain and Abel story and see Christ and see that it's a parable and that it has a deeper meaning. okay, because that veil is taken away from my eyes. I'm not looking at that Cain and Abel story and saying, oh, this really happened, or Cain really killed Abel, or who are, you know what I'm saying? Or, well, I'm not looking at it from that perspective. I'm looking at it from a spiritual mindset now. I have more of a spiritual outlook on what took place in the Bible, and it applies to my flesh and my spirit. That is what the veil being done away in Christ. So it says, but even unto this day, when Moses is read, and I say even unto today, when Moses is read, the veil is upon their minds or their hearts, because they still can't see that what Moses was talking about was it's being revealed in the New Testament. What Moses was talking about was that Christ that's within you. Okay, so it says, now the Lord is that Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. But we all, with open face, behold as in a glass the glory of the Lord, are changed into the same image from glory to glory, even as by the Spirit of the Lord. Okay, so I wanted to touch on that just to show people that, no, it's not saying the veil is taken away and that just means all of a sudden you go back to the Old Testament and you can see that the Israelites was black people, or, you know, you believe in all of these literal things in the Bible. No, that's not what that's talking about. That's talking about the veil is done away in Christ. Now, what is Christ? That's what let's touch on what Christ is, because there's a lot of antichrist out here. There's a lot of people that are antichrist. So let's look at Christ. Okay, let's find out what the Bible defines Christ as. Blue, if you want to add something while I look for it, you can. If you want to, if not, I got to find this verse.
And we got some questions too, but go ahead.
What was that?
Now, I'll see if we got some more questions as well. But, you know, whenever you're ready.
Go ahead. They can go ahead. You can read them. I mean, you can read them.
All right. All right. So let me get rid of these social media questions first. Then I'm going to go to the chat room. Be wise as serpents. What's going on?
I'm surprised they don't want to call in. it's easy to converse. But go
exactly,
ahead.
Exactly. Exactly. Yeah, you want the number 319-527-6239. Make sure y'all call in. But let me read this one right here. It says, do we need the Bible to understand Christ's consciousness as a whole?
No.
All right. Quick to the point. The next one, what's the origin of Christ's consciousness according to the Bible? Did it start in the heavens, or did it begin on earth when Adam and Eve was created?
Christ is God, so Christ is eternal. So no beginning and no end.
All right, Brandon Blue, you want to try to respond to that?
Yeah, I agree with what Bleedo said. It's eternal.
Yeah, I mean, we put words on things, right. So I mean, if somebody want to say when the word was created, or, you know what I'm saying, the term Christ consciousness and things of that nature, then that's something totally different. But, you know, the view of Christ being God, God is eternal, so to ask, you know, when did this Christ come into existence, that would be like to ask, when did God come into existence? That's how I would view that question.
Okay. We got a couple questions from my brother, Be Wise as Serpents, in the chat room. I'm going to be the clean. The clean version of the questions.
Oh, you cursing?
He says,
I don't know what that is.
Kind of going off in there. Can you show me the word Bible within the Old Testament or New Testament? The word Bible only exists on the cover. Can you break that down?
Yeah, I agree with him. I mean, the word Bible is just, when I looked it up a while ago, I don't know, you know, trying to remember the definition, I believe it just means books. So, you know, it's not as, I mean, that's why I said I went outside of the Bible and went to the Essenes Gospel of Peace, you know what I mean? And then even the books is within you, you know, it tells you that in Revelation 5, that there was a book written within. So, I mean, we even have the words within us. So, yeah, so the Bible, to say the word Bible, is in the Bible. No, I ain't never read it, but it just means books.
He made a few comments too. He says, Moses is not a metaphor. Christ is at least a metaphor. Moses is a metaphor. Christ is not G-O-D. Christ is simply an aspect of God, not the entirety of God. Well, you want to say that, anything about that?
Moses, this is something that I wanted to bring out too, with how, you know, we can look and read the Bible. When you look up, Moses is a symbol. If you look up, hold on, I gotta get you this. So hold on, I'm gonna have to pull this out of my phone real quick so I can show what I'm talking about real quick. Okay, so. And then he's saying Christ is not God, okay? And again, I'm using the word Christ, not Jesus, so he understand that I view Christ and Jesus totally, it's not the same. Christ is the
wisdom. Yeah, hold on, stand by. Sorry about that. Let me follow up. It says Christ is simply an aspect of, I read that already, G-O-D, not the entirety of G-O-D, divinity. So...
So my answer to that is just Christ is the wisdom and the power of God. So Christ is, you know what I'm saying, it's not a being. It, like I say, it's energy. So it's God. You know what I mean? It's no separation in that.
All right, Brandon, do you want to take a shot at that?
I think Bluto answered it well.
Okay, because I want to show them this Moses thing real quick, because he said that Moses, I just had to pull this up in my phone, I'm sorry, man, but, okay, so the word Moses means drawing out of the water, okay? So one becomes a Moses, or one could become a Moses when he's drawn out of the water. The water in the Bible represents or is a symbol for cleansing. Okay, so Moses had to go through the water, and I can break out. I don't want to go too deep into that, but just know that Moses' name, which is not like how we use names, it's like blue and that's his name. Whatever. These are symbols. The name is a symbol, just like when we look at Emmanuel. Then you go into the New Testament, and it say being interpreted, God with us. Jesus' name wasn't Emmanuel, so we have to understand that a lot of these things in the Bible, if not all of it in the Bible, are symbols. So, you know what I'm saying? Like, we can look at Egypt, and then it'll give you the symbol of what Egypt means in the Bible. It says Egypt is the house of bondage. So it's not talking about, when you see Egypt in the Bible, it's not talking about the place Egypt. It's talking about the house of bondage or being in bondage. That's what it's dealing with. So we have, when we read the Bible, again, and if, when the veil is removed, then we begin to understand the symbology that's written in the Old Testament. Like I say, the New Testament is easier to understand the parables and the allegories because they are written so plain. But the Old Testament is a little hard to understand the allegories because they're not really written that plain, but they are. You know what I'm saying? We know fish don't swallow people and things of that nature, and we understand, and I can go a lot of different ways with that, but a lot of people have a belief system, and they believe that that to be true. But it's like I say, but these things have meanings. Like I said, Moses just means to be drawn out of the water. You could look at drawn out a lot of different ways. They left Egypt and crossed over the Red Sea into the Promised Land. That's being drawn out. You still got water from the sea going up. Like it can be broken down. And it makes sense when you break it down from that perspective and not look at it literal, because you can it has something to do with you and your life, and you can and you can understand it more or understand it more within yourself. So that's what I wanted to say to that.
All right. Once again, family, you know the number, 319-527-6239. You want to go to the chat room, you know what to do. Go to the Blog Talk Radio website, click on the link, and scroll at the bottom. It's a little box there where you can interact with me or anybody that's inside the chat room. Be wise and serpent. We appreciate your questions and keep them coming. I'm going to keep reading them. But we do have some callers. I'm going to get back to the chat room. We do have some callers. Let's go to 443-815 live.
Hey,
Sam,
it's showtime.
Hey, what's going on, fam?
Yeah, this is Brother Mercy, man. How you doing? I just had a question for you. I just had a question for Bleedo. You ain't gonna speak to me, bro?
You ain't gonna speak to me, bro?
I'm asking you a question there. I said, hey, B-Dog, I'm messing with you. I ain't gonna do you like that last time, bro.
I'm messing with you, bro. You good. Go ahead.
But look, I got a question for you. You said Cain and Abel, you talked about the story of Cain and Abel, and you said Cain was according to the flesh, and Abel was by the spirit or something like to that effect.
That's how I could look at that story.
And you mentioned Paul, right?
Yeah, well, Paul say the flesh war with the spirit and the spirit with the flesh.
In that story of Cain and Abel,
you can see that the flesh basically slew or killed Abel. You know what I'm saying? The good or the spirit or the life, or however you want to view it. And that's what take place pretty much in the Bible, because when you look at even further down, when God said, my spirit shall not always strive with man because the evil of his imaginations or something along those lines. So you can see that even in the story, further along down the line in the Bible, that it seems as if the flesh is winning. And you can see that even in today's world, that it seems like the devil, you know, some people believe in the devil or Satan, is winning the war against God, because it'd be few that be there that find life. So if the way to destruction and death is broad, then of course you're going to look at it and say broad is, you know, is winning. So that's just how I view the story. I don't feel like it's a right or wrong in how one may take it. You know what I mean? Anybody there? Hello? Can I be heard? Hello?
Yeah, I'm sorry. I had to mute my man for a minute because it was some background noise. Let me bring him back in, though. Hold on. All right, you back in, brother. I didn't mute you. I had some background noise. Mm-hmm.
Okay, well, here's the question. I know you made that comparison or that allegory, but did Paul make that allegory when he compared the flesh and the spirit with Cain and Abel? Did he make that comparison? Was he talking about Cain and Abel when he wrote that epistle?
No, he didn't mention Cain and Abel when he said the flesh war with the spirit and the spirit with the flesh. No, he didn't mention those two.
Okay, which two did he mention?
I had to go there and look at it. Hold on, I can pull it up. I ain't got that wrote down. I can go there though. I know it's in Galatians. Galatians 5?
Yes. Sarah and Hagar.
Yeah, the allegory, I don't think that was the one though. Nah, that ain't when you say the spirit war with the flesh and the flesh with the spirit. Nah, that ain't that one. I think it's Galatians 5 though. I'm gonna look it up though. But go ahead, you can make your point. I found it already. We good.
Okay, this is my point, real simple.
Okay.
When he talks about something born according to the will of the flesh and that of the spirit, he wasn't talking about Cain and Abel. He was talking about Isaac and Ishmael. And the reason why that's important is because I don't think he's making the same point you're trying to make. Because Isaac and Ishmael are two way different sons than Cain and Abel, you know. Because you look at how they were born, you can see how one was born according to the will of the flesh and one was born according to the will of the spirit. With Cain and Abel, Scripture talks about that too. But it doesn't talk about the flesh and the spirit. And that's the only thing I wanted to point out, is that just because something is fleshly doesn't make it wicked. What they were talking about is the will of men and the will of God. That's it. That's the only point I was trying to make.
And let me ask you what you're saying. I agree with that. That makes a lot of sense. But what I was trying to point out was, you know how I said that when she had Cain, we were given a man from God. But then when it said that they had Abel, it didn't really emphasize on them being given a man from God. And then you can see the emphasis on Cain tilling the ground, which we know that God had cursed the ground. And you can see that Abel was a tiller of the sheep. So we understand that in the Bible, that sheep and things of that nature represents pureness, and it represents the spirit. And then we understand that the ground, which was cursed in a sense, it represents being low or being down. So that's what made me draw that parallel. Now, I'm not saying that, you know what I'm saying, you could take it to the bank, because you ain't got to follow what I'm, you know, follow me in a sense. But what I'm saying is, if I look at that story more of a flesh versus spirit versus looking at it as two people who existed and, you know, one killed the other, to me, it makes more sense to me to draw it from the concept of how the New Testament actually reads.
Well, I live in a city where people kill each other every day. So, I mean, murder is not something new. I mean, it's something that happens pretty regular if you watch the news. And I just wanted to say,
You know, I'm in Chicago. You know, I live in Chicago. I mean, I'm just saying, I live in Chicago. So, but I'm saying more from a spiritual perspective. I understand what you're saying outside of that. You know what I'm saying? That's why, I mean, I don't like if we look at the like we look at being in the gates, and outside of the gates, we have all these evil things taking place outside of the gates. You know what I mean? Or without the dogs and whoremongers and things of that nature. So we know. Outwardly, we can see those things, but inwardly, we inside the gate, we protected, we comforted. You get what I'm saying?
Let me add one more thing, though. But let me add one more thing. That's true. The ground was cursed. But let me say this. The sheep also live off the ground. So Abel's sheep ate off the ground that Cain was working. You understand what I'm saying?
Okay.
And, you know, and so you're right. The ground was not producing a lot. Let's just imagine. I'm going to throw something in. I'm going to throw a little wrench into what you're saying. Let's say Cain is working real hard, right? And he's not getting a great harvest because the ground is cursed. So he's not getting a great harvest. And a little bit he's getting, Abel's sheep is eating up. Now, just imagine that just for a minute. Because, I mean, the sheep got to eat. The little bit that he's getting. the little bit that Cain is able to produce from the ground, Abel's sheep is eating up. So he has very little to offer. He has very little to offer on the altar. Because
like I say, bro, like when you like how you breaking it down, in my opinion, like I'm not saying there's no right and wrong in how you perceive it. But you're looking deeper in the story, and you're looking into the deeper meaning of the story, in a sense. You get what I'm saying? You're like, man, look, the sheep could have been, you know, doing this and doing that. That's what I'm talking about as far as how the Bible or the law and things of that nature, that's what gives the Bible life. Because we're not looking at it as something that's just written on the page, and we're trying to validate all these things, and we're sitting back saying this is what we got to do. We're actually looking at the mysteries of the Bible, and we like, man, we drawing contrast to it, and we making it make sense. That's what in that scene's Gospel of Peace is talking about. He said the scriptures is dead, not saying that the book is something wrong with the book. It's just like, but the way we reading it. We reading it as a dead book, and we're not bringing life to it. You know what I mean? So you can take that story and explain that story to, you know, your children or whoever. You know what I mean? But if you explain it to them in a life form and you say, hey, look, this took place, this is this, you know, this corn is this block over here is cursed or whatever. However you break it down, you know what I mean? Now you're making things make sense, bro. So then won't nobody be like, man, we need to burn up this Bible because it don't make no sense. You get what I'm saying? So that's all I'm saying. I'm not one of those people that's saying we don't need the Bible. You know what I'm saying? What I'm saying is the teachers need to start going into the deeper meanings of the text and start showing the people the deeper meaning of the text, and they'll start to search within themselves, and they'll find those answers. You know what I'm saying? Within their own life. Because we all live in different places.
I think you have a very literal under. And see, I kept it literal though, Bleedo. I gained meaning because I actually been on a farm, so I understand that sheep have to eat, and I understand that sheep usually eat from the ground. See, so in order for me to grasp these things, I have to have some type of application, some type of. I mean, you in Chicago, brother. So you should be able to see the Cain and Abel thing. You know, you should be able to understand it a little bit.
I see it all day. Nah, it is. But that's what I'm saying. Like, even if you say it's being broken down literal, that's kind of how parables are. You know what I'm saying? A parable, you know, Christ will say the sower sow the word or sow the seed, and then he'll say it fell on stony ground, and then when it fell on stony ground, this happened. This is how you illustrate a parable. You know what I'm saying? If a worker worked for 12 hours, this dude worked 11 hours, he got the same pay as the one who got, you know, who came in and worked that 1 hour. It's a story. You get what I'm saying? But within that story, it has a deeper meaning. That's all I'm saying. And when I say deeper meaning, I mean something that could apply to one, you know what I'm saying, spirituality or one's life. That's what I mean by that. I'm not saying nothing outside. It ain't like I'm saying I'm smarter than you or you smarter than me because you – no. I'm saying Christ can lead you to understand life through that book, without that book or whatever, and we can converse in spirit and we can understand one another. That's what the language of the spirit is.
But see, the problem I have with what you're saying, Bleedo, is you say stuff like it didn't happen. See, I don't like that because that makes it seem like it's a made-up story. It makes it seem like it's a made-up story.
Go ahead.
You said it ain't like it really happened. You know, you say stuff like that. So that makes it seem like it was a cleverly made up story. You see what I'm saying? And see, that right there is a little dangerous to me because that makes it seem like that somebody just wrote this made up story and just, well, if that's all the Bible is, then it's really nothing. It's really a piece of trash because I don't need made up stories. I don't need that. I don't need somebody in their room making up stories, bro. All
right, look. So check this out. So when Jesus gave a parable, right, we're just going to use a parable. When he said, I'm going to use the worker. He said a worker go in and work 12 hours in a day, right? He's giving them a story. Are you saying that it don't make sense for him to speak in a parable to the people?
No, but what I'm saying is you're conflating different situations. We're talking about Cain and Abel. We're not talking about a parable. We're talking about Cain. And then you say Cain and Abel never existed. See, I'm not talking about a parable.
Okay.
See how you switched it up on me? I'm talking about Cain and Abel.
No, I'm saying, I didn't switch it up on you. Listen to what I'm saying. I'm saying because a parable is a story. And you say
that don't mean the whole book is a story. That don't mean the whole book is a story.
I mean, what you think you read?
Even if you take Cain and Abel literal,
how is that not a story? It's still a story. It's not something that you didn't physically witness what's going on. You didn't physically write it. I mean, even if you wrote it, it's still a story, though.
No, but you say stuff like it didn't really happen. So you make statements like that. See, that's what I'm trying to say to you. If I see one man shoot another man, and then I write it down, that is a story. But then you go back and say, "Oh, that really didn't happen. He just said that."
No, I hear what you're saying, and maybe what I mean by when I say it didn't happen, like I'm not saying it because let's say this for example, like okay, so I'm gonna use the resurrection for an example. Okay, the resurrection is an event, right? Would you agree with that?
I definitely would agree with that.
Okay, so if you were a futurist, I'm just throwing something out there. If you were a futurist, then you will believe that event is to take place in the future. Okay, if I'm a preterist and I believe that, you know what I'm saying, it takes place or this event takes place, then I'm not saying that it didn't happen. I'm saying that it does happen. So maybe I'm wording that wrong. So that's why I say I heed your correction in what you're saying. Maybe I'm wording it wrong when I say it didn't happen. Maybe I should say it does happen. You know, like
that's
it
much
happened.
Better.
Yeah. Okay. I heed the correction. So you do know that there's different applications to the Bible, and some people take it as history. Some people take it as being fulfilled already. So you know what I'm saying? Like we can go in the Bible all day. And, you know, we can go in a book and create a doctrine. That's why so many different debates. And that's why, you know, we can talk all day about it. But the goal of it all is the kingdom within us and that Christ. Would you agree to that? Well, Christ. I just say Christ. I want you to say the kingdom within us because I don't know if you agree with that.
Oh, I agree with the kingdom.
Okay. So that's the whole point. So that's my whole point of even doing this. It's just to show people that there's a kingdom within us. God is within us. The law is within us. There's nothing outside of yourself I mean, other than like what you just said, killing and all that, you know what I'm saying? But that's nothing outside of yourself that you can't go within yourself, and God can lead you in His law.
And you're aware that in a kingdom you have rules, regulations. You are subject. You are subject to somebody, correct?
Yep,
you are subject to somebody. You have to follow somebody's rules, somebody's regulations. That's all I'm saying. So when you say you don't have to belong. No, but listen to me, though. When you're inside of a kingdom, you got a king. Just like this country. You're in the United States of America. You're subject to the president, whether or not you want to agree to it or not. You're subject to rules and regulations. I mean, whether or not you want to agree with it. It's not just Christ, brother.
But listen, though. Okay, so what I'm saying is, so look, in that kingdom also, it says love your brothers and your sisters as you love yourself. So you subject to love, and that's you know what I'm saying, that's really the fulfilling of the law is the love. So yeah, you subject to law. The law is summed up in love. So I agree with that. You know what I'm saying? I'm not saying that I'm law, that I walk around like, you know what I'm saying, like you say, that we are the temple and the spirit dwell in us. So of course if God's spirit dwell in us, it's gonna lead and guide us. The only problem that I see amongst like our conversation is that people wanna turn back to the physical law because they can't, because they're not being led by the spirit, and they don't understand that the physical law are just symbols. That's it. And that physical law is what drives you to death, because that's what gives you those evil desires. Like I can tell you like this: if I say the Sabbath day or is Saturday or whatever, your mind is still going to want to do what your mind is going to want to do even on Saturday, bro. Even if you feel like you're doing something for God. God don't want you to feel that way. So that's what I'm saying. So the Christ that's within you is not going to tell you to sit in the house on Saturday.
So do you have a job, brother?
Of course, yeah, of course.
And then you have to pay taxes, right?
Man, if I didn't.
And that's not a symbol, brother. That's not a symbol. That's not a story, brother. That's not just in your mind. Okay? You have to physically do that, okay?
Yeah.
Matter of fact, they don't even let you
do it.
They take it out your check before you even get it.
I got my views on that, you know what I'm saying? But for the most part, I understand what you're saying. So, yeah, I physically got to wake up. I physically got to go to a job. I physically get a paycheck. I physically pay taxes. I physically pay a mortgage. I understand what you're trying to say. So, yeah, those things are still, and even in what we're talking about now, it's still a physical application. That's what people, I think that's another thing that people miss. You know what I'm saying? It's still a physical application. So I'm going to go into, I got a few more scriptures that I'm going to go into as far as breaking that down. But like I said, I'm not telling nobody to change nothing, bro, because it ain't me. It's Christ, bro. Like, if Christ is within you, then Christ will guide and lead you. I'm not trying to lead you and say, hey, man, you ain't got to do this law. You ain't got to do this law. I'm just pointing out that the laws in the Old Testament are symbols. You know what I'm saying? That's all I'm saying. It's a symbol that leads you to Christ.
So you pay taxes just a symbol?
No, I'm paying taxes. What you mean?
That's real, right, brother? That's all I'm saying. The Old Testament is real, brother. That's all
okay.
What I'm trying to make.
So look,
it's
so,
real, brother.
So
it's
okay.
Not just a symbol,
before,
brother.
Before you leave, real quick. So is Christ within you real?
Of course, it's real.
Okay, we good then. So that's all.
It's not
that's
just
all
a symbol.
If
that's the whole point. I understand your symbolism.
But the Bible is symbolic, bro. You know, I mean, I'm just saying. Okay, so like I'm saying. In the book of Isaiah, it says his name shall be called Emmanuel, right?
Yes.
Okay, then when we go to Matthew, it says being interpreted as God with us, right?
Yeah, yes.
Was the Messiah's name Emmanuel, yes or no?
The Messiah's name was not Emmanuel.
Jesus,
but he shall
whatever. We don't even got the name. Right. Let's keep it simple. So I'm saying, so it said, and his name shall be called Emmanuel. What's the Messiah name, Emmanuel?
No, he said he shall be called
So that's what I'm trying to get you to see. It's a symbol. Emmanuel was a symbol that means God with us. Okay, so when you read the New Testament, it gives you the symbol. It's telling you Emmanuel, which being interpreted means God with us. That's all I'm saying. So when I say things are symbols, like the temple was a physical temple in the Old Testament. You can see a physical temple being built, all that, the cubits, all that. But then when you get to the New Testament, it tells you that you are the temple of God. And then even when they get into measurements and all that, that's dealing with the mind. Like, I can break all that stuff down, like how it deals with the mind. But, it you know, it ain't that I ain't going into all that. You know what I'm saying? But I'm just showing you that you can still see a symbol. So you can't say that what I'm saying is not making, you know what I'm saying, it's not making sense when the Bible itself is doing that. I'm reading out of the Bible. The Bible's saying what the symbols is. I ain't making it up.
So is your government name Bleedo?
On record, yeah. I changed
okay.
My name, but yeah.
Okay, I'm just saying, that's your government name.
I'll tell you my original name, yeah. I don't got no shame or none of that.
Oh, I'm just asking. The reason I'm trying to make a point, when you growing up, your friends might have had a nickname for you, right, Bleedo? I'm just saying. Most people, when they growing up, they got a nickname. I'm just saying. Most people, your friends or family members might have a nickname for you. That's not your name, but that's what you are called. You see what I'm saying? By some type of attribute that you have. Normally you have some type of attribute. They call you something based on something you did or some type of act, some characteristic. So that's the same thing with Jesus. His name is Jesus, but he was called. He was called.
I'm just saying, we ain't got to debate it. It's just a symbol, bro. That's all. I mean, you can look the word symbol up, bro. It's a symbol. Like, even a nickname is a symbol. Like you said, it's an attribute you have. You was fast, they might call you quick. If you were slow, they might call you slow. You were chunky, they might call you chunky, bro. You know what the heck? It's just a symbol, bro. It's really not that hard. And once we understand that it's all a symbol, then everything lines up and it makes sense, bro. Why do you think, and I'm going to ask you this question, and then I'm going to finish, bro, because I don't want to be on it too long. But why do you think people hate the Bible, bro?
Because they don't think it's real. Cause this is your whole premise. You keep saying it's all a symbol. You keep saying that's what you said. That was your. I don't think you realize what you're saying.
Okay.
You're saying it's all a symbol. Cause that's what you're saying. You're saying it's all just a symbol. Those were your exact. You didn't listen to the tape.
Those were your exact words.
Maybe that's not what you mean.
I said no because I don't believe that's why they hate the Bible. But go ahead. I wasn't saying no that I didn't say it was a symbol. I was saying no because I don't believe that, but my bad. I didn't mean it. I shouldn't did that. So you go ahead. You can finish your thought.
Yeah, I was going to say, first of all, they don't think it's real. Second of all, when you think something is not real, you can't properly apply it in your life, especially if, like you say, if it's not being taught properly. Then you can't properly apply it. And then you don't think it's real. Then it becomes unreal because if you got a wrong teaching, it becomes unreal. You see what I'm saying?
So you saying if the story in the Bible didn't literally happen, then you wouldn't even deal with the Bible. So let me ask you, so if the story literally didn't happen in the Bible, would you believe in God?
Well, now you're talking about ifs, ands, and buts. But see, the thing is, it did happen. See, that's what we got to deal with. We can't say if. See, in my world, it's not an if. It happened.
You said it.
So for me, if it didn't happen, that's just craziness. I mean, that's just craziness. I mean, you in Chicago, somebody got shot, or what if it didn't happen? No, it did happen. We need to find out who did it, right? Because
we can prove somebody got shot. We can't prove Cain and Abel existed. We can only believe in Cain and Abel existence. I can prove to you somebody got shot. I got a record of that. You can pull up a record. I can't ask you if he got shot because you can go right and pull it up. He got shot on such and such this day. You can't pull nothing up outside of the Bible to prove in the existence of Cain and Abel. And on top of that, even if they did exist, I don't even want to really get into that whole if they did or if they didn't exist argument. Even if they did exist, the moral of the story is what, though? So the conclusion of that story and what do you get out of that story, is that what's important or their existence is what's important?
What is important is that you understand that it's truth, because truth will benefit you in every situation. It'll benefit you. If you don't think, because see, if you say it's just a story, then I would say that it didn't happen. And then if it didn't happen, then the criminal don't get caught. Because that man that got shot, and you sit up there and say, oh, nah, that didn't happen. I mean, come on, we got a record of it. Like you say, we got a record of Cain killing Abel. We got a record. We see it right in Genesis. But you say it ain't no records. We can't prove. So, I mean.
I got you, man. All right, man.
Yeah, I appreciate you, man. We got some more callers, but if you want to press number one again later on, you can. Again, the number is 319-527-6239. Anything else you want to bring out before we get the next caller? Yeah, Vito, anything else you want to bring out?
Yeah, let me, because I conclude it, because I ain't going to be too much more longer. Let me bring out a few. I got to touch on. I got to touch on Romans, man. I got to at least touch on that, and then I'll take the rest of the callers.
All right, you got it.
Let me get that. Mm-hmm. Okay, so let me get that real quick. And then I'll take the rest of the callers.
Now, remember, you got Brandon Blue standing by.
Blue, you want to talk? Yeah,
no, I'm just listening. I'm sitting back listening.
Okay. All right, cool. I'm ready now. So, all right, this is the book of Romans, chapter 7. All right, so I want to read all this, so I'm going to skip down since it's 8:30. So then, all right, cool. All right, so I'm going to start at verse 4. Wherefore, my brethren, ye also are become dead to the law by the body of Christ, that you should be married to another, even to him who is raised from the dead, that we should bring forth fruit unto God. Going back to bringing forth fruit, offering Cain, Abel, whole thing, same, lining right up with what we reading already. For when we were in the flesh, the motions of sin, which were by the law, did work in our members to bring forth fruit unto death. Now I want to really look at that. So it says, for when we were in the flesh, the motions of sin, which were by the law. So now remember, we have a law that's connected to sin and death. Okay, did work in our members to bring forth the fruit unto death. But now we are delivered from the law, that being dead wherein we were held, that we should serve in newness of spirit and not in the oldness of the letter. So we see here that we have a law. So a lot of times, like when I used to go to a certain camp, I'm not going to put nothing out there, but they would teach a sacrificial law. They're talking about the sacrificial law. That's dealing with the sacrificial law. Well, the word sacrificial law is not even in the Bible. It doesn't even appear in the Bible. So that's just something that was passed down through tradition. The sacrificial law and the law are all one. There's no separation between the two. As we see in Genesis, when Adam was breathed the breath of life, there was no death. There was no sacrificial law. There was none of that. The moment death came in, the moment the law came in, then death came in, because he said, if you eat of this tree, you're going to die, okay? So this is where sin and death is attached to the law, okay? So it says, what shall we say then? Is the law sin? God forbid. Nay, I had not known sin but by the law. So this is clear. This is not saying that the law is, this is talking about no animal sacrificing law. This is the clear-cut law that we read in the Old Testament. For I had not known lust, except the law had said, thou shalt not covet. But sin, so what is sin? The transgression of that law, taking occasion by the commandment, wrought in me all manner of concupiscence. Now, let me look this up in another version. I think it broke it down a little bit more clearer. Okay, so let me read it. This is the New International Version. It says, but sin, seizing the opportunity afforded by the commandment, produced in me every kind of coveting. So now his mind, because this law was put on the table, thou shalt not covet. So now his mind is thinking. He has the same way when he said, don't eat of the tree. The mind wanders off. Okay, wanders off. It want to do what this law is telling it not to do. Okay, so this is the law of the flesh, because now the flesh is, it wants to do what you're telling it can't do. Okay. So it says here, for apart from the law, sin was dead. So it was no law, there was no sin, there was no death. I was alive, okay? Once I was alive apart from the law. So before the law, Adam was alive. When the law came, Adam died, okay? This is what this is dealing with. This is why I'm telling people, like, when you think about keeping this outward law, and you're telling people this is what you do, or you boasting in what it is that you do, or things of that nature, you're still dwelling in death. Okay? It says, but when the commandment came, let me go back to my other version. Okay? Go back to the King James. Okay, for I was alive without the law once, but when the commandment came, sin revived and I died. Okay, so that means that when the commandment came, sin came back because the commandment is attached to sin and sin is attached to death. Okay, and the commandment which was ordained to life, I found to be unto death. Okay, so the commandment, the outward flesh, or whatever it is that he found to be the life, that it was ordained to life, he found to be for death, right? Why? Because in the mind, this is what the Bible did. This is what the new covenant is about. This is why it says, I will put my laws in a inward part. You know, they were saying that, well, in the last conversation, it was said that if you have the spirit, then you will carry out the law. And what I wanted to say to that, and I really didn't want to debate, but what I wanted to say to that is, that people understand the sacrificial law is spiritual, but they don't do it. People understand that the lamb, that Jesus was the Lamb of God, but they don't slay a lamb on Passover. So they understand the spiritual nature of the law, and there's certain things that they don't do, but yet they try to boast in the law and say, hey, do you eat kosher? If you eat pork, then you know that's against the law. That's against the law, brother. You know what I mean? This is what they tell people. Okay, but this is why Paul said, this is why it's written, which what he found was ordained the law, he found it to be unto death. Okay, for sin taking occasion by the commandment deceived me and by it slew me. Wherefore the law is holy. Now, what law is this? What law is the law that's holy? And the commandment is holy and just as good. Okay, so now we went from dealing with the law of sin and death to now dealing with a law that is holy. Okay, this is dealing with the spiritual law, the inward man, the light in the law that's within. That's the law to life. So this law is holy. But the carnal law that he thought was ordained to life, he found that to be the death. So how could that carnal law be unto life? It can't be the life. How many Judaism or people that in the religion of Judaism or the Jews in the land or whatever, people say, oh, they ain't the real Jews. But they're keeping the commandments. They're keeping the Sabbath. They're keeping the feast. But they don't believe in Jesus. What does it mean to believe in Jesus? What does it mean to believe in Jesus? Because you say you believe that he died on the cross for your sins. Okay, you believe that. That's not nothing that's physically attached. That's something that you say. But yet you do the same thing that they do. You keep kosher, they keep kosher. But y'all don't even have the same spirit. Y'all can't even rock together. Y'all can't even stand in the same room. So how could the outward commandments be to life when there's so much confusion? When you got so many different brothers with so many different camps, but they claim to keep Torah. So this Torah that you believe in can't be the life, because if it was to life, it'll be peace. It'll be joy. It'll be love. It'll be long-suffering. That's a problem. How could that be holy? How could that be just and good? How could it be? Okay? So I wanted to bring that out, and I could go further in, but let me just read the last couple verses, and then we can you can take the rest of the call and finish this. It says verse 19. I'm just gonna skip down. For the good that I would do, I do not, but the evil which I would not that I do. Now if I do that, I would not. It is no more that I do it, but sin that dwelleth in me. So sin is something that dwells within man. Okay. I find then a law that when I would do good, evil is present with me. Why is that? Why is if you keeping Torah law, evil is still present with you? Why is when you doing what they say you supposed to do, your mind wandering off into thinking about other things? Why is it that? Why is evil present with you, right? Because that outward law is attached to death. For I delight in the law of God after the inward man, but I see another law in my members, warring against the law of my mind. So now he's talking about a law in the mind. Okay? He sees another law in his members, his brothers, his kinsmen according to the flesh. Remember, Paul was a Jew. I mean, Paul was a Pharisee. Paul kept the what's name, but he killed the Christians. He slayed the Christians. So he was keeping Torah, but yet he was still slaying the Christians. So this Torah was still unto death. It was still warring against the law of the mind. And bringing me into captivity to the law of sin, which is in my members. What's the law saying? The law of sin is death. This is what he's bringing out. Oh, wretched man that I am, who shall deliver me from this body of this death? I thank God through Jesus Christ our Lord. So then with the mind, I myself serve the law of God, but with the flesh, the law of sin. What is the law of sin? We can't say the law of sin is killing animals. We can't say that. That's what he was talking about. So there was a law that contained what? His flesh. That was outward law. He's talking about now inward law. This is what I'm saying. So when these people was telling you, or when they are saying to you, you know, that you're supposed to keep kosher diet, or you're supposed to keep this, keep that, whatever it is, those things are attached to death. Those things are going to come with desire, because those are going to be things that you want to do. Now, I'm not saying, okay, you go out here and kill somebody, whatever it may be. The Spirit of God won't lead you into none of those type of things. And it may still do, because if you look at the Bible and the story of Judas, Jesus gave Judas a sop, and Judas betrayed Jesus, and Jesus had to die. So that was still a will of God. So even evil, in a sense, is the will of God. It's all in how you perceive it. Like I said, those who see things in the spirit see things, evil and good, as a balance. We don't look at things as a separation. This is why I'm saying this inward law and things of that nature. We're dealing with the balance, because we are flesh, but the spirit is within us. So we have to understand that. So I just wanted to end with that, and we could take some callers, and then, you know, we good.
All right, we're going to go to the callers. But first, before we do that, let me go to the chat room again. My brother in the chat, man, Be Wise as Serpent, he's bringing up a whole series of questions. I can't get all of them.
He sounds like he wanted to debate, man. That's what he said.
Yeah, you know. You know, number 319-527-6239 for those who want to call in. But Be Wise says, Bible does not mean book. Bible means papyrus or paper. He says, can you show me the word religion in the Bible?
The word religion is inside of the Bible. I think it's in the book of James. James 1:27. It is, the word religion is in the Bible. So tell them James 1:27.
Oh, he can hear you. He's here.
It just says pure religion and undefiled before God and the Father is this, to visit the fatherless and widows in their affliction and to keep himself unspotted from the world. That's what it is, pure religion.
I hear something that he brings up that he feels like most of it didn't see. D-O-G, what does that spell, Lito?
D-O-G?
What does that spell? Yeah, D-O-G, what does that
God,
spell?
God backwards.
There we go. There you go. That's what he said exactly. He said, guess no one ever noticed that. All right. But, yeah, you got a lot more he said. But let's go to the callers, though. Once again, 319-527-6239.
Yeah, I'm over here now looking at all this stuff he trying to drop on. I don't know what he's talking about.
you're in the chat, right? So let's go to.
I'm looking at the chat now. He got a whole novel, man.
Yep. Let's go to 716-541. You're live.
Thank you, Sal, for taking my call. This is Sister Doris, and I want to say that I am enjoying the dialogue, for the simple fact is his the title is the letter versus the spirit, and you know the spirit of the law should be going forth on tonight because that's what the topic is. We already know that there is a letter of the law, you know what I mean? Because you get hammered with it, you know, every day in the groups or some calls. And he is exactly right in everything that he is saying. The Ten Commandments were always meant to be spiritual, you know? They were always meant to be that. And the law was just a schoolmaster, you know what I mean, to Christ. Everything that he is saying, I don't know if he believes in the Bible or not, but, I mean, you know what I mean? For somebody, they say that you don't really believe in it, but it sounds like you do. And we have to embrace both, you know, the spirit and the letter. You understand? Because they say, oh, well, Christ died for the sacrificial law. That is not true because they were not doing animal sacrifices at that time. So then you have to think to yourself, okay, well, what does this mean or what is this saying? You know what I mean? There is a spirit of the law. You know what I mean? Because if you live by the law, you're going to die by the law because that's what the law says.
Yep.
So you were doing a beautiful job, and I wanted to say, so far as your analogy with Cain and Abel, that was spot on, because Cain and Abel is the first example that we give. So if we piggyback with Esau and Jacob, they're just going to be piggybacking off of Cain and Abel. Okay, now, and he was right, so far as his analogy regarding the birthright. You know what I mean? Esau, he did not cherish his birthright, and neither did Cain. Cain was first born, so he already knew that he was supposed to sacrifice a lamb. He knew that. But like I said, God is merciful. You know what I mean? The law was don't touch that tree. Okay? He told them what the law was, but they did it anyway.
Yeah.
But he was merciful. But, yeah, there is a spirit. Christ brings the spirit of the law. You're doing a great job. Thank you.
Appreciate it. Appreciate it. I'll praise to the Father.
This is Doris. We appreciate that as always, calling into the program. Everybody else, I see y'all listening, but if you want to chime in, simply press number one and we'll add you into the conversation. This is Summer Special. This is the final week before we go off the air again and come back September 23rd. For season 10 of Debate Talk Free Radio. So if you have any questions or comments in regard to this topic, letter of the law versus spirit of the law, part two, the number is 319-527-6239. Then press number one, and that lets you know that you got a question. But nobody else is pressing number one at this time. Brandon Blue, do you want to chime in?
I really don't have anything to add. I think Bleedo hit all points. So yeah, I just continue sitting back and listening.
Yeah, it's a big Bible, and like he said about the Jacob and Esau, like I thought about going in that direction too. It's just a lot that you can cover. So it's like, you know, it's a lot of stuff I still didn't even hit, you know, with the Christ being formed in you and things of that nature. But I just hope people understand that, you know, that the spirit of the Creator, or the spirit of God that dwells within us is something that's real. And you know, we just been taught these things through religion and these traditions, and it's okay, Max. I ain't trying to attack nobody, say nobody wrong or whatever, but we have to understand it's just something deeper than that we could obtain. And I mean, if some people was good and, you know, just seeing God in a religion fashion, then you know, I salute to them and more power, you know, to them. But I'm just here to proclaim that the spirit is real and that it's true. Same way that, you know, I read about Christ and Christ saying I and God are one. You know, those are things that he was saying.
Yeah, I apologize. Just letting you know, we do have another caller. All right, so once again, the number is 319-527-6239. Feel free to ask your questions or forever hold your peace. You can also email me, debatetalkforyou@gmail.com. That's debatetalk, the number four, letter U, @gmail.com. However, if you're on social media, you know my inbox. Inbox me, and I'll read your questions. Let's go to 510.
You did it all just so powerful.
Man, a whole bunch of noise. All right, you got it back.
Hold on, let me move out the room. Yeah. Hold on.
Like he in the studio.
All right, is that better?
Yeah, you good now.
All right, how y'all doing, man? This is Vinny D. What's up, Bleedo? What's up, Brother School, how y'all doing, man?
Peace, bro. Peace. All
right. That's a sort of my debate league name, you know what I'm saying?
It's about to get real.
Yeah.
I just got a question.
I know you called it.
I don't go in like that, man. I just listen from time to time. But,
I'm playing, man.
I'm not going to cut you out. they got a good little platform over there. I like listening to it. But I do have a question. Like, you was talking about the law of sin, right? And
okay.
That's all I could really chime in on, because that's where I came in at. Is
okay.
What you said? What is your understanding of the law of sin? Like when it's talking about in Romans.
Okay, so when you look at I went to Genesis and I broke down. So I kind of just expounded on Adam. When God breathed in his nostrils the breath of life.
Mm-hmm.
That's when the spirit of the Creator, in a sense, was in man. The law of God was in man, because the word law is a symbol for light, and a symbol for light is God. So
mm-hmm.
When God gave the commandment, he said, in the day that you eat of this fruit, you're going to die. So the commandment
mm-hmm.
that was given was attached to death. Okay, so when we read the story, like, we got the first Adam and the second Adam, we know one from the earth, one from, one is of the spirit. I didn't really get a chance to go into all of that, man. I had so much more I was going to go into. But when you look at sin and the law
mm-hmm.
of sin, it's attached to death. And when you look at the law of God or the law of Christ, it's attached to life. So when you look
mm-hmm.
at a lot of people today, I'll just give an example. They use the Torah law, which would be the Old Testament, which is a symbol. That was like the Sabbath and things of those natures. Those are symbols to point us to Christ. That's like the schoolmaster.
Mm-hmm.
But when you see people today, they say, man, we got to keep these laws. We got to go back to this covenant that our fathers broke. Or we got to go backwards. And God don't want us to look back. We're supposed to look forward. But now when you go backwards and you look at the way that they're trying to keep the law now, they're taking you right back to death, because your mind – It has evil desires that's connected to it. So, like I say, if somebody want to keep the Sabbath on, let's just say they keep the Sabbath or whatever, right? Their mind is
mm-hmm.
going to be like, man, I want to do something else. I want to watch the fight. I want to watch boxing or whatever it may be. You know what I'm saying? I want to go to the concert. I want to go to a basketball game. Your mind is constantly warring against that outward law, because that outward
mm-hmm.
law is something that man has always, if like I say from the beginning, always went against. But the law of the spirit don't do that. The law of the spirit is not going to say you can't go to a basketball game, because you understand that the Sabbath could be obtained through meditation, that the Sabbath could be attained. You can rest. You know what I'm saying? You can rest even within yourself outside of meditation, because that's really the purpose of the Sabbath. You know what I'm saying? And like I told, when I told the other brother, from a physical perspective, we have labor laws. So from a physical perspective, let's say your job, you work 5 days. I don't know. Let's say you work Monday through Friday. You have
mm-hmm.
Saturday and Sunday off to rest from your job. That's the physical
mm-hmm.
side. You know what I'm saying? The physical side of how one would perceive the Sabbath. But what Christ is talking about, what God is talking about, is rest to your soul. No job can give you rest to your soul.
Okay. I mean, I hear what you're saying. I don't necessarily agree all the way with it. I agree to
okay.
a certain extent. Like, because when I read it, like the law of sin, I would agree that it's something, it's to death, right? But the
okay.
law of sin has nothing to do with the most, with the Most High's laws,
Okay.
Like, it's just like when Paul was talking about, like what you said, like you warring with yourself, right? But
uh-huh.
instead of giving in to your desires, that's why they say, that's why he says you die. You have to die every day. You know what I'm saying? Because you have to keep
exactly.
fighting off your fleshly desires, and the flesh is sin. It's the sin that goes against the commandments. You know what I'm saying? And
okay.
my understanding when I read the text. When with those sacrifices, the sacrifices wasn't taken away because, they were useless. You know what I'm saying? Because they were always meant to be a covering. They were just snatched away because Israel, wasn't sacrificing right. Like when you go to Isaiah 58, it talks about how the Most High is not accepting those offerings because, they were not offering with a pure heart. Like the animals was perfect. Nothing wrong with the animals at all. But it was the people that was bringing the offerings, because that's who, when you really, dig into it, like the sacrifices really represent the people. You know what I'm saying? Like
mm-hmm.
that's supposed to be you on that altar dying, but instead
yep.
you have a covering and something else is going to be dying. And that's why that was the main importance of Christ. Like, he would compare, you know, himself to the serpent on the pole, right? So, mm-hmm. like, when the Most High said, you got to go look at that serpent if you want to live, right?
Mm-hmm.
And if you didn't look at that serpent, then you was going to get, when you got bit by them adders, then you was definitely going to die, right?
You're
so
die,
everybody who didn't look at the serpent or look toward the serpent, basically symbolizing to me, like when I understand, is symbolizing like you recognize the faults, you know, you're repenting, you're like, oh, I done messed up, I'm sorry, you know, and then you look at that serpent and then you change and then you survive. He lets you survive, right? But
uh-huh.
with Christ is the same thing, you know. He kept telling them, just like Nineveh, he also compared himself to Nineveh, you know, and he said that the people of Nineveh got saved because they actually listened.
They repented. Yep.
And they repented, right, from their wicked ways, right?
Yep.
And but that generation was not doing that. You know what I'm saying? They just kept giving in to their fleshly desires. You know, they had all type of idolatry going on. Not necessarily saying that they was bowing down to, like, you know, calves or nothing like that, but anything that you put over, you know, what you're supposed to do, what you know you're supposed to do, that's right, then that's idolatry. You know what I'm saying? So,
right.
I mean, I definitely agree with a lot of what you guys say, like you and Brother Blue School, and you know,
let me show you something real quick about what you're saying. I agree with what you said as well. I think the maybe the disconnect, which I'm trying to see if maybe the creator can lead me to see if we can kind of see eye to eye a little bit closer. Okay, so
mm-hmm.
so look at I'm gonna go to Exodus 34:28, and it says Well, I started 27. Saying, the Lord said unto Moses, write thou these
mm-hmm.
words, for after the tenure of these words, I have made a covenant with thee and with Israel. And he was there with the Lord 40 days and 40 nights. He did neither eat bread nor drink water. And he wrote upon the tables of the word, tables of the words of the covenant, the Ten
mm-hmm.
Commandments. So the Ten Commandments was the covenant. Okay, this was something that was outwardly, in a sense, because it was written on tables of stones. When you go into
mm-hmm.
the book, when I read in Corinthians, but I'm going to show you something else. But when I read also in Corinthians that we are the ministers of the New Testament, written not with ink, but with the Spirit of God. So now,
mm-hmm.
when we look at it from that perspective, there's no, and I'm not telling you not to, you know, keep no law on that, you know, so don't get me wrong. I'm just trying to see if we can kind of see what, you know, you can see a little bit deeper what I'm saying. So
mm-hmm.
when we look at, let's just say the Sabbath, because we could say thou shalt not kill, but then we can still look at, you know, they were still killing. So therefore, that
mm-hmm.
you know what I'm saying, they still broke that law and they still killed outside of that. We can still see thou shalt not commit adultery, and we understand that they still was committing adultery. So these things
mm-hmm.
were in their mind, and that's why in the book of Hebrews, it kind of go into that where it talks about the consciousness of men. So it's not that something is wrong with the Sabbath day. You know what I'm saying? It's nothing, because it has a meaning to it. Like I say, it's rest to our souls. But when you look at it from a physical perspective, it has no, it really has no power. It's like you keep a Sabbath and another brother keep the Sabbath, but yet you guys will still disagree as far as on the text. You know what I'm saying? So if the law was to life, or was to that road to life, then you keeping that Torah and that other brother keeping that Torah, y'all shouldn't have nothing to debate about. Y'all should have no issues, because the Torah will be the way to life. So you see what I'm saying? So when you see like me and Blue, for example, like me and Blue may not agree on everything. Like, it's nobody that you're going to, you know, see that's going to agree on everything. But when we talk
mm-hmm.
in spirit, we talk in the language that both of us comprehend. You know what I mean? Like, school of understanding, he'll tell you, like, he may not have reached the point that I've reached through the scriptures. He might have reached it through another, you know, another way. But we still come together, and that spirit is still there. You get what I'm saying? It's still like where two or more is, I'm there. So, but I wanted to show you this real quick. I know I could talk. Let me show you this real quick. So
uh-huh,
I can talk, man.
Good.
I ain't gonna lie to you.
Don't worry, it's all good.
Okay, so notice, you know how it said that covenant, and it said that it said that it was the Ten Commandments, right?
Mm-hmm.
So when you go to the book of Hebrews, and I'm going to read this one, but it says, then verily the first covenant had also ordinance of divine service in the worldly sanctuary. For there was a tabernacle made, the first wherein was the candlesticks and the table and the showbread, which is called the sanctuary, after the second veil. You know all of this, right? And about the Ark of the Covenant and all that, right?
Right.
But then
right.
It says, now when these things were thus ordained, the priest went always into the first tabernacle, accomplishing the service of God. So now that all that stuff that took place was a part of that first covenant. Would you agree with that?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay. So he's saying that the first covenant, this is all the things that took place. It says, but unto the second went the high priest alone once every year, not without blood, which he offered for himself and for the errors of the people. The Holy Ghost, this signifying that the way into the holiness of all was not yet made manifest. So we see here a signifying symbol, it's kind of like same type of words. Whereas the first tabernacle was just standing. So we see that there's something that is talking about, but that is the symbol. Now we're going to go into something that goes beyond what we read in the Old Testament. And this is what I'm saying about the new covenant and the old covenant, the letter of the law and the spirit of the law. The letter of the law is something that's physically outside a physical building, a physical temple, physical sacrifices, physical Sabbaths, physical feast days. But then when you get to the New Testament, it's spiritual this, it's spiritual that, it's spiritual this. You see what I'm saying? So when a person says,
right,
we got to go back to the physical, it's like, why would I go back to the physical when the new is telling me not to even, you know what I'm saying, that old covenant is vanished away, it is no more. So why would I go back and deal with those things, which you really can't because you don't have a tabernacle or a physical tabernacle because we are a tabernacle. You see
right.
what I'm saying? You don't have a physical Ark of the Covenant. No, go ahead, bro.
Sorry, I cut you off. I was going to say, yeah, it's spiritual now because he ain't accepting that no more. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
But, and the only time you're going to start accepting it is when we start listening to what he had to say. Yeah. Hold on one second. What's up? Okay. Hold on. I'll be in there in a second. Okay. All right. So, you know, like when you read the prophecies, all of that stuff is going to be coming back. You know what I'm saying? And it's all dependent.
Right. So that's
it's dependent on his time.
Yeah. See, that's the thing that led me away from the whole little understanding was that when the Bible say that he was offered once and for all for sin. And then somebody tell me that, you know what I'm saying, his sacrifices is going to come back. And then when the Bible also say sacrifice and offerings I did and I won't, but he wanted, he'd rather have obedience. And then somebody telling me, no, to me, just my opinion, that was the Antichrist spirit because that was somebody teaching against the Christ. You know what I'm saying? Because Christ, when it talks about Christ dwelling within us, that's really like dealing with the second coming, you know, or the resurrection, because we are that body that Christ dwells in. It's like biblical marriage when he says that Paul wrote that, you know, that the church and Christ is one. So how could somebody tell me that when Christ comes back, like when I'm already married to Christ, you know what I'm saying? So how could he come back?
Right.
You know
well,
I mean?
I think where like a lot of confusion comes in is like, just seeing that sacrifice for sin, you know, that's only one offering right there. A sacrifice for sin is only one offering. You got the peace offerings, you got the goodwill, you got all these other different offerings. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
Sacrifice for sin was taken away because that was the covering, right? Israel was so wicked. Like even when you go to Christ, when he was teaching the people, remember when he told the people, I think it's in Matthew 5 or somewhere around there, or I might be way off, but anyway, he was talking about, you know, when you go to the altar, if you got anything that you need to reconcile with your brother, go reconcile with your brother, then come back and give your gift. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And that's not what they was doing. And when you read about the prophecies, like in Isaiah, when the Most High was super, super fed up, especially Isaiah 58, it tells the exact same thing. You know, it's telling you what the people was not doing, and he got fed up because you remember he's slow to anger, right? But then when that wrath come, then that's it. You know what I'm saying? It ain't no get back. You gotta hop on your high horse and do what he tell you to do. Otherwise, you're gonna get knocked down just like they did in the wilderness. You know what I'm saying? So
okay. It's all a process.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so look, so then that, I mean, not to say be wrong or nothing like that, but then that goes against what's written in, like, that's why I went to Hebrews 9, because you mm-hmm. was talking about, like, sacrifices and peace offerings and things of that nature.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that's why I was telling you, the Holy Ghost is signifying that the way into the holiness of all was not yet made manifest. So, again, the Old Covenant, and when you read the Old Testament, these are symbols. These things were manifest. They weren't revealed yet. You know what I mean? And in certain instances, people can break down the spirituality in the Old Testament. But like I say, the New Testament is more straight and plain. So it says, while mm-hmm. as the first tabernacle was yet standing, which was a figure for the time being present, in which were offered both gifts and sacrifice. That goes to what you were just talking about, the peace offering, gifts, and things of that nature. That could not
mm-hmm.
make him that did the service perfect as pertaining
right.
to the conscience, right? So it's dealing
right.
with, so why would he set that up in the future when in the past it didn't make the people perfect? It was the services that
right.
they did, the drink, it didn't do. So what's the point of bringing it back? That's what I'm saying.
Oh, my bad, bro. Go ahead.
No, you're good. I just asked, what's
okay.
the point in bringing it? If Christ is the perfect way, and Christ being within
mm-hmm.
us is the way, how, I mean, that's basically like saying the way that things are set up now with Christ being within us is not perfect, because he got to come back and do, I can't get with that, bro. That's why is like when I was studying full preterism.
I hear you.
Full preterism. When I was studying full preterism, I'm like, this make more sense
mm-hmm.
because they believe the whole Bible was fulfilled. And, you know, they was breaking it
right.
down from more of a, you know what I'm saying? And I'm like, I can roll with that more than I can roll with, you know, saying that Jesus got to come back
right.
or that, you know, because the Bible clearly
is
going against that.
His main purpose was to teach us what? How to be perfect, right? How to walk like him and be just like him,
mm-hmm.
spiritual like him, right? Because we
yep.
somewhere along the line, we lost it. I mean, the blueprint was already set. Like, the law was always there to teach you how to be, you know, just like the sacrifices, you know. Sacrifices was never really about the animals. It was always about the people. The temple was never really
right.
about a building. The temple was always really about the people, right? That's why they always
yep,
make
the
those comparisons to one body. Exactly, right? So
yep.
it was always supposed to be that. But then that Hebrews also tell you that the reason why they couldn't get it was because they lacked faith. You know what I'm saying? Like
yeah.
they was given everything that we was given, right? But they didn't have no faith. And I don't know how, because they saw all the miracles. You know what I'm saying? If I'm seeing
right.
miracles and I'm seeing stuff happen, guess what? You know where I'm gonna be right up underneath their feet.
But that's what I was saying about the law of sin and death.
Mm-hmm.
It's attached though, because like even if you look at the knowledge of good and evil, when one intakes the knowledge of good and evil, he sees things from a dualistic perspective. He sees one
mm-hmm.
side and not both sides. So, because even in that story, it say man has become as one of us
else.
To know good and evil. So we see that God,
right.
Christ, the angels, or whatever you may believe that to be, you know what I'm saying? I don't know what a person believe that to be. In that context,
mm-hmm.
we see that there are some beings that know good and evil and still live. You understand
mm-hmm.
what I'm saying? But man, because he sees this separation and he's separated from God, he couldn't eat from this tree because of these thoughts and these desires, because of this law of sin and death. Is what I'm saying. So this is what
mm-hmm.
Christ, with Christ being within us, has brought us back. And the crazy part about it, bro, and you know, I know a lot of people, you know, when we were going to Sunday church, you know, whatever, I don't even like to say Sunday church, I just say Christianity in a sense.
Mm-hmm.
They were actually teaching some truth. Like, they were actually
they do. They
but,
do.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
I ain't going to deny
because,
that.
Yeah, but because, you know, when we, I don't know if you were Hebrew. I don't know, you know, like what your, you know, what
yeah,
your
I went
face,
through the
I
stage. I went through that stage,
yeah, I'll
bro.
Just say when I became a Hebrew, I just say me.
Mm-hmm.
When I became a Hebrew, I mean, the camp that I went to, they took me away. They turned me against everything about
Sunday. They
hate it,
yeah.
Mm-hmm. Everything about it. So sometimes when I talk now, I'll be like, man, I sound like a Sunday preacher. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
But it's nothing wrong with teaching love when you understand what love is. You know what I'm saying? Because a Sunday preacher can really understand what love is, but his heart, he may not understand it. His heart may not be right, because a lot of people teach for money. You know what I mean? So, mm-hmm. I mean, I just wanted to say that. I mean, I don't disagree with
you.
Like,
good deal. Yeah.
Yeah, man. Yeah. So, well,
I would like to have a dialogue with you, though. Yeah, definitely. Thanks, y'all. Your brothers have a good night.
Yeah, we could. Hey, mm-hmm. whenever you want to have a dialogue, I'm open to it, man. Like, that's, I don't want to debate, though, man. That's why I ain't in the Soul Division debate league, because that's too carnal for me, man. I ain't about to be doing all that screaming, and I'm good. I'm trying to be peaceful. So, we could do a dialogue. You know, just hit me up and we can set it
up. It's all good. All right, bro.
Okay.
Y'all have a good night.
All right, peace.
Peace.
All right, you too. Peace.
All right. Yeah, let me just say peace to that brother Vinny, man. I love that brother's spirit and his humbleness.
Yeah.
I just wanted to say that.
Yeah, definitely. I do too.
All right, Vinny. Uh-oh. We got some more background noise. But yeah, man. Once again, the number is 319-527-6239. I see we had somebody pressing number one earlier, but they took themselves off. If you chime back in, press number one again, and we'll bring you back into conversation. Again, today's show is entitled "Lit of the Lord versus Spirit of the Lord." This is part two, guys. This is part two. You can always go back and catch part one in the archives. So if you missed part one, go check that out. But this is part two, and I appreciate the feedback, the comments, the questions, the emails, you know, all of that. Because, you know, the more questions you guys have, the more answers that's put out there, the more people can learn. So we appreciate the family out there for interacting on the show. But, yeah, nobody else is pressing number one, bro.
Okay, we can close it out.
All right, so let's get some last words in. Once again, we appreciate Brandon Blue for standing by and adding his information as well. And, Bleedo, you can start with Brandon Blue. Last words.
Yeah, I just want to say, yeah, this is a good show. This was Bleedo's show, and I think he laid out some great points. And, you know, I was just here to support and give some info when I could, but I think the brother did a great job. Thanks for everybody listening in. And thank you, Sal, for the platform, and peace to everybody.
Appreciate it, Blue.
I appreciate you, Bleedo. Any last words? Go ahead.
Yeah. Okay. I want to thank Sal for giving me the opportunity to come back on here and present the information that I really wanted to that I wasn't able to present in the first dialogue. Second, I want to thank the callers. I mean, it was pretty peaceful, not a lot of negative energy. To be a true Christian or to be a true Christ is to be in peace and walk in love. You know what I mean? We've been growing up, and especially myself growing up around a lot of hate, a lot of negative energy, a lot of anger. And I myself was a part of that, was one of the debaters that just, you know, was just, I don't know even the word to use, but I wasn't nice, you know what I'm saying? So I want to, you know, let the people and show the people and display the fruits of the Spirit that the Creator has instilled in me, you know what I mean? And I want to always walk in that Spirit, even if sometimes I may get in the flesh or get carnal. I want people to always look and say, man, that brother, you know, transformed from being carnal to being Spirit, because I want to represent that Christ. You know, when anybody think of the Christ that's within, I want to be a representation of that. And when I say I'm just, you know, not necessarily the flesh, but I, the inward man. And I want people to know that you also can walk in peace, walk in love, and even in disagreements with people, if you don't, you know, agree with them, you can still walk in peace and walk in love. And at the end of the day, that's really what being a true Christian is all about. It's not about being puffed up. It's not about, you know, having all this knowledge and trying to have people follow you and things of that nature. You know, I never wanted that. I never chased that from the first time I got on this platform. I always, you know, basically was like, don't follow me. You know what I mean? I want people to understand that Christ is real. You know, the power of God is real, and that power, it dwells in you. All you have to do is do what the Bible says. It says the kingdom of God is within you. The key of the kingdom, or the enter into the key of the kingdom, is to those who enter into themselves. So what you have to do in enter into that kingdom is enter into yourself, and understand that that's where the Creator is. As Jesus stated, that I and my Father will make our abode with you. So to understand that, that means that they will live with you, live within you. That's very literal. You know what I mean? Like, that's not metaphysical. That's very literal. because the Creator will dwell and Creator does dwell in you. So I just want to, again, say thanks to the listeners. And, you know, again, I appreciate Sal, and hopefully be back soon.
Once again, Vito, I thank you for kicking off week two of the Summer Special, man. You know, I appreciate you. We're definitely going to bring you back on the program. So hopefully everybody took their notes and enjoyed the program. Again, we're going to have Vito back on in the near future. By the way, we do have a show tomorrow, family. We do have a debate going on in the Lions Den. Debate Talk for You. Title of the debate is Yeshua the Most High or the Son of Yah? Once again, it's Yeshua the Most High or the Son of Yah. We're going to have Brother Jason. Brother Jason is back on Debate Talk for You Radio versus Brother Ron. So make sure you tune in tomorrow. Keep a lock right here on Debate Talk for You Radio. And once again, family, please support Debate Talk for You, guys. Help keep this program on the air. Again, we need your help to remain on the air for the remainder of the season. So show your support. Go to the description box, and if you want to support the program, you'll see it. Oh, by the way, if you want to have shout-outs, if you want me to play your shout-outs on the air, your audio shout-outs, all you got to do is send it to debatetalkforyou@gmail.com. That's debatetalkforyou@gmail.com, and we'll hear your shout-outs, you know. Don't make it too long. Make it at least maybe a minute and a half so we can play, say your name and what you like about the show. All right, guys, so we appreciate you. We're going to see you guys tomorrow. Take care, and God bless.